Wavesound presents an unabridged recording of Work From Anywhere, How to Become a World-Class Distributed Team by Alison Hill and Darren Hill. Narrated by Daniel Moore.
To those who make our work and world extraordinary. Looking at you, PT crew. Prologue. You don't need to be told about the ripple effect or chaos theory. How a butterfly flapping its wings on one side of the planet can cause a hurricane on the other. You know how globally connected we all are, and how one event thousands of kilometres away can sweep the whole world, affecting every person and business. We all understand this now, in our bones, because we all experienced this via the extraordinary events of 2020. Bracketed by the mighty Yangtze and Han Rivers, the pulsing city of Wuhan is home to over 11 million people. In late December 2019, this Chinese provincial powerhouse had a thriving economy and a grand history. However, it would soon be known worldwide for something else entirely. Wuhan would become ground zero for the most contagious and lethal virus the planet has known in 100 years. At first, the ripples were barely noticeable. A small but significant increase in pneumonia cases raised concern among the local doctors and healthcare workers in Wuhan. The Wuhan Municipal Health Commission reported this worrying cluster of viral pneumonia cases on its website, and the World Health Organization started to track events. Barely a fortnight after the early identification of this extremely serious respiratory virus, experts confirmed a novel coronavirus, or COVID-19, as it would soon be known across the world, had been identified. The first reported death due to this strain of coronavirus was reported on the 11th of January 2020, and from there, it would march its way not just through immune systems, but also across land, sea, and air to tragically claim the lives of well over a million souls and counting in its first 12 months, bringing the global economy to its knees along the way and changing workplaces around the world forevermore. Originating in the subtropical corner of southeast Queensland, Australia, Pragmatic Thinking, PT, you're welcome to do a little cyber stalking at www.pragmaticthinking.com, is something of a rarity, both by profession and by perspiration. Founded in 2008, it has achieved what very few businesses get to do: keep its doors open for over a decade and reach revenue well beyond seven figures. Pragmatic Thinking is a behaviour and motivation strategy company supporting organisations with leadership development and culture change, the people stuff. Fewer than 0.06% of businesses ever achieve these combined feats, so you might think that would be a chance for all involved to sit back and indulge in a little self-congratulation. But survival was never the primary objective for anyone at PT. It was to be magnificent. So, alongside existing for over a decade, the PT crew also achieved excellence, as evidenced by many measures, including being named in the Australian Financial Review's Fast 100 across three consecutive annual lists and being one of Asia Pacific's fastest growing companies. It was an exciting business with an exciting story, working with exciting clients. January 2020 saw the team gather for a two-day offsite to map an ambitious and invigorating journey for 2020 and beyond. This was a regular cultural kickstarter the team looked forward to each year, outlining new goals, new plans, and new hope. With a focus on accelerating marketing and new product development, the crew at PT had ambitions, goals, and energy to make the start to a new decade an energetic and prosperous one. All that came to a crashing halt, however, on the 13th of March, 2020. Sitting glued to the news briefings with most of Australia, aghast as Prime Minister Scott Morrison outlined the initial isolation and shutdown measures being undertaken to stop the community transmission of COVID-19 across the country, the team at PT were genuinely fearful for the future. While the team had plenty of strings to its bow, delivering services in training, consultancy, and internal communications, the vast majority of those services relied on a face-to-face delivery model. Across the next week, the business lost upwards of 90% of its projected revenue streams. Along with live events and tourism, the education and training sector was among the most significantly affected. On top of this, the team and culture that they had created was in keeping with this high-touch approach. The PT vibe pre-COVID was one of hugs and fist bumps. It laughingly could have been described as an introvert's minefield, in all the right ways. But clearly, that all had to change. It's not an overstatement to say that unless a radical rethink could be achieved in a short space of time by everyone at PT, complete failure was imminent. Fast forward 12 months, and the bleak future faced back in March 2020 was replaced with a vibrant, exciting new direction. The PT crew switched, almost overnight, from a traditional but very cool co-located team in two funky offices to making its way as a separately located team with an uncertain future to finally building excellence in functioning as a hybrid team with a commitment to performance as strong as since its inception. Commitment to this type of reinvention and the action required is not a common tale. However, it is an achievable one for any business that has entered into being a distributed or hybrid team. The ripple originating in mainland China that turned into a worldwide tsunami, a global pandemic worse than any other in living memory, crashes into businesses, having severe and sudden economic impacts on them and the teams within them. Sadly, this collision had impacts some businesses have not and will not recover from. But for others, the chance for radical reshaping might just be the making of them in a new era. Occasionally, the world engineers a moment in time that's so big, we're compelled to make change to stay relevant. For all of us, 2020 and the events within it was that moment. A moment when work from anywhere moved from being a fringe business practice to mainstream business as usual. A moment when every team on the planet had to rethink how teams operate. Introduction. Having teams operate in a distributed or work from anywhere, WFA, fashion is not new, and nor was it solely born from the global pandemic. For years and even decades, many teams have managed to facilitate a functioning work environment remotely, some spectacularly well. A few rare companies with valuations now in the billions have been distributed for decades, or at least since the advent of the internet. Yet the sheer impact of COVID-19 and the overnight call to remote and distributed work practices reshaped workplace behaviour and standards so significantly that, in time, we may speak historically about the events of 2020 as being as disruptive for workforces as the invention of the printing press and the personal computer. Exacerbating this significant change is the sheer speed of change. The suddenness of overnight isolation-based crisis responses from organisations left many leaders, teams and businesses floundering. Many are still battling with leadership and cultural skills that were built on face-to-face connection rather than virtual. But help is here. Regardless of whether you're still struggling to adapt, you've had some wins, but feel a lot of unrealised potential is still there to tap into, or you're flying and just looking for a few handy tips to take your game to an elite level, this book will make for enlightening listening. Be assured, the framework and methodology that underpin this book are grounded not only in behavioural and psychological sciences, but also in lived experience. Why WFA is here to stay. Co-located workplaces will undoubtedly continue and will likely be a considerable construct of workplace teams into the future. Certainly, some industry types and job occupations simply demand that teams be located under one roof. Manufacturing, bricks and mortar retail, healthcare and hospitality are all industries where it seems natural to have many teams working together closely and, in some cases, in front of and face-to-face with their customers. But the ripples of COVID-19 will continue to move through all businesses long after a new normal is established. Put simply, The requirement of organisations to offer and adapt to WFA practices as a regular option is now here forever. Companies including Twitter, Facebook, UBS, Shopify, and many others have instigated permanent WFA policies. Reports have found the surprising results that, having ditched the commute, workers are reporting increased productivity, lowered stress levels, and improved reconnection to a healthier lifestyle. How work-life balance is considered has changed permanently. If you're still a dissenter, believing this whole hybrid, remote, distributed team stuff is simply a holding pattern until everything gets back to normal, let's take a look at some factors that give us the confidence to make these statements. Continued globalization. One of the huge economic megatrends that has been catalyzed further by the internet revolution is globalization, and not just for the gargantuan organizations. Business without borders has also been the place for mid-tier businesses. The ability for an organization to set up shop in geographically diverse areas across the globe with a small, inexpensive footprint has radically reshaped expansion plans compared to two decades ago. A small team, or even individuals, can provide an opportunity to prototype offerings to marketplaces at low costs. With the rise and rise of functional distributed teamwork, these outlier employees can still have a connected and impactful presence within the larger organization. Increased adaptability and flexibility. The push for organizations to provide more flexibility in work practices has been a couple of decades in the making. The macro generational shifts of two full-time working parents and Gen Y and millennial-led work teams have continued to shift the focus of teams to being more adaptable and flexible. Recent research suggests that to be competitive in the talent marketplace, you need to have options available beyond the co-located team. And these options need to be more than just a token, and no longer based on old ideas that staff need to be monitored and the office is where real work happens. The concept of what work is and when work starts has shifted. Therefore, the ability to source talent from a broader geographical location is required for organizations of the future. Cost savings. Chief financial officers around the world have celebrated the shift to WFA more than anyone because of their connection to the numbers that drive the business. The reduced costs are varied, but the two big reductions are reduced commercial rent. Fewer people at the office means fewer square meters of office space. With rent often one of the biggest fixed cost line items for businesses, even a one-day per week WFA arrangement equates to a potential 20% reduction in staff on premises, which can trickle to a significant reduction in required office space. Reduced travel and accommodation expenses. With the business world becoming much more accepting of virtual discussions within teams and also in-client contact, there have been massive reductions in air and land travel. Many business development and sales teams are reporting even more effective outcomes via virtual connection rather than playing calendar Tetris trying to arrange a face-to-face meeting. Of course, accommodation goes hand in hand with travel. You reduce travel, you reduce accommodation costs. Habit formation. While the preceding points certainly provide a compelling business case for organizations and teams moving towards distributed work from a financial standpoint, we'd argue an even more powerful driver of distributed work staying as an ongoing way of work is simply the length of time many teams spent in COVID-induced isolation. While many theories posit how long it takes to form a new habit, within 28 days to 2 months being pretty common, right around the world, lockdown periods have exceeded the vast majority of these accepted beliefs. Put simply, we've done enough reps for this way of work to now become deeply ingrained muscle memory. What if WFA is actually the best way to work? Before we throw ourselves headlong into the philosophy, structure, and exploration of what you can do to achieve excellence as a distributed team, We want you to sit in this glorious question, filled with possibility. What if WFA is actually the best way to work? We're curious. How comfortable has that question left you? Your gut feel. What was the first intuitive response? Let's rate it, shall we? Let's see where you're starting your journey from. Think about your response to the question on the following continuum. What if work from anywhere is actually the best way to work? If we put rubbish on the left as a necessary evil we had to endure, and absolutely on the right as the perfect mix that supports a modern workforce, were you more aligned to the left side of the scale or the right side? Truthfully, we're ambivalent about your response. What we're much more interested in is your desire to shift to the right on this continuum. The fact you're listening to this book tells us you're searching for answers and looking to make WFA work better for you and your team. Regardless of where you scored yourself, a useful belief to hold will be that embracing a WFA approach for your team could enrich the lives of your people and their work. To be super frank, not super frank, the spandex-wearing accountant, but super frank, as in lacking tact and abrupt, pining for the days of cohabitation is a waste of energy and your intelligence. It's our belief that you can lead and thrive as a team working from anywhere, whether in a distributed form or as a hybrid team. The gifts from this are not just a flexible work environment, but also a deeply autonomous one, built on the kind of performance standards and cultural togetherness that creates the very work engagement we've quested for. When we explore a new model and methodology with new ways of working and connecting, the very things we've been craving from work become possible. That's a quest worth pursuing. But let's check in for a second. We're not asking you to drink the Kool-Aid, nor are we encouraging you to join the WFA cult. We're just offering a simple exercise in shifting your perception. Holding the belief that when you make WFA work, well, it might just be the greatest work invention since the stand-up desk, or Marty's brownies, is where we want to start this 200-odd page journey together. Because the alternative is pretty ordinary, if your belief is that WFA is the poor cousin of the office-bound team, you'll likely create a self-fulfilling prophecy. Your energy will be reflected and radiated throughout your team, and you'll see problems instead of opportunities. Let's not do that. Let's dare to create something special. Using this audiobook. Coming up ahead, you'll hear a carefully considered rhythm established within the first chapter, which we carry throughout the audiobook. Story, systems and science, and summary. Story. Each chapter starts with an insight into pragmatic thinking's journey from a close-knit, high-touch, co-located team to a high-performing hybrid team. We'll tell this story through a classic method, following the time-honored meta-plot structure of the hero's journey, coined by academic Joseph Campbell in his seminal work, The Hero with a Thousand Faces, in 1949. The monomyth of the hero's journey is an enduring storyline that we tend to see replayed in the telling and retelling of an adventure. We're unabashed fans of Campbell's work. The Hero with a Thousand Faces is one of our most referred to sources, and while vigorous debate has occurred academically around the use of metaplots and their accuracy, more impactful voices on the constructs that drive mythology than Campbell's are hard to find. Within his work, Campbell suggests that all great and enduring myths follow a similar storyline. Whether it be a section of the Bible or Quran or the script from a Star Wars film, the elements are the same. The lived experience of the transformation our business has undertaken, our quest, our hero's journey, holds the book together and provides both a narrative and chapter structure. Along the way,
we trust you'll get the sense that this book isn't a non-fiction business book without heart. It's written by people for people, and the journey comes to life through our experience and our people. Systems and science. The majority of this book is dedicated to the careful consideration of making WFA teams extraordinary. We don't present you with information to just be a little less shit. Rather, we want a team that others look to for advice and guidance. Imagine a time in the not too distant future when leaders and teams ask, "How the heck did you get your team going so well?" Our hope is this book and the tools and practices we provide you with help make that a reality. Backed by psychology, social science, and anthropology, this book should be viewed as a meta-analysis of ongoing scientific research into workplaces and human interactions. Not a typical academic paper dotted with bibliography, but a culmination of science and lived experiences. In addition to the research, we unpack two spotlight case studies of organisations tackling the shift to hybrid work. An iconic Australian brand, Laminex, share how they answered the call to the adventure, while the likes of a media company, Ooh Media, share some of the challenges they are facing and overcoming. Mind you, this approach should not be confused as systematic. You won't find a Seven Secrets of Success or our step-by-step approach to team success vibe in this book. Instead, we provide an array of viewpoints, research, and lived experience for you to create your own cultural system and framework. While we don't provide a set formula for you to follow, the strategies, tips, and tools suggested are built on psychology, research, and science. When it comes to engaging, connecting with, and motivating people in this new world of work, that's our bread and butter. We'll also throw in super useful tips and suggestions for practices that will help your team thrive. But in the same way as every team is unique, this book doesn't take a cookie-cutter approach to team excellence. Summary. At the end of each chapter, you'll find a concise summary of the key takeaways and suggestions to help develop your WFA team, along with some links to extra resources, recommended reads, and things to tune into. We've also provided an opportunity for you to have a coaching check-in. These key questions allow you to take some time to digest the information in the chapter and apply it to your own situation, team, and organization. Beyond this book, our aim is to give you years of practice to work through with your team as you head towards and maintain WFA excellence. Some definitions. We're genuinely excited to bring you our findings on how to make your team even more brilliant than they are right now. Before we go much further, let's get clear on a few of the terms we use throughout. Work from anywhere, WFA. Our general classification for this term is the ability of employees to work independently of any singular place within a team. It's not about creating a four-hour workweek style of vocation where you're working on a tropical island selling multi-level marketing or solopreneuring your way to stardom. So, if you're at home one day, in a bustling metropolis the next, and then at a convention, remember those, or on a road trip, you can and should still be able to be productive. The definition applies to those who may be located away from the office, if there is one, and may choose to work from an alternative location for a period of time too. See change, anyone? Hybrid team. This is a team where some members may be co-located with others in different locations. This makeup isn't static and can change depending on demand and load. Our belief is that a considerable number of teams in the future will be hybrid in nature. Distributed team. While this may seem interchangeable with hybrid team, the real difference is if a team is fully distributed. This is where a team works independently of each other constantly. The business headquarters or central office doesn't exist, and all the work is done in different locations. Is this audiobook for you? Well, we certainly hope so. Lest you've just burned a few bucks you could have utilized for a nice meal and a glass of red, well, a cheap one at least. This book is for three audiences. One, the team that's just formed or been thrown into a distributed culture for the first time. Two, the team that has been navigating distributed and hybrid work for a while now, but knows more potential is within them. Three, the established hybrid team looking for the small but important gains to help them go to a truly elite level. Whether it's the working examples of organizations, case studies of practice, or the real-time laboratory that has become pragmatic thinking, you can rest assured that everything you hear and explore has been road-tested and has a foundation of practical application, not theory. But this alone won't make this book work for you. We've yet to really discuss the single most important variable for success. You. When you finish this book, reality may just kick in. You'll be sitting on the wrong side of a lot of hard work. You can't simply manifest team excellence into existence. It'll require your best effort and perhaps even an effort level and standard you've not yet delivered as a leader. The process will be uncomfortable at times. You might have to challenge long-held beliefs and even face your deepest fears. But we're with you, because the fight is worth fighting. We spend one third of our lives at work, so it should be an extraordinary experience. The stakes are high. Okay, sorted? Good. We've got lots to cover. Our quest begins. It's funny, you know? Here at Pragmatic Thinking, we've been to more conferences than we care to remember, either as attendees or as keynote speakers, panel members, or content experts. We used to join the throng, eat the conference food, and talk the small talk with the best of them. An ongoing chuckle for us was how almost every conference in the years prior to 2020 included talk of the speed of change. We used to revere how fast our world had become, while also worrying about how the pace of life and work had quickened. Then COVID-19 said, "Hold my beer." The world has shifted. Okay, it's always been shifting, but this time, 2020 specifically, the shift was tectonic. The economic, cultural, and strategic ground shook under a global business community's feet. And it's certainly going to be looked at as a monumental moment in time for the team at Pragmatic Thinking. For upwards of 6 months, we moved from being a co-located team in a funky, decked out, culturally appealing office, a space that our partners craved coming to hang out in, to being fully distributed. We've now settled into being a hybrid team, a working construct that will remain permanently. Truthfully, the shift to a hybrid distributed team has been a revelation for us as a business. If you'd told us at the start how many benefits and upsides would come from making the shift, we would have politely smiled and nodded and thought, what a load of bullshit. You see, we'd created a cracking culture as a co-located business. Ours was a culture so good that the greatest business development strategy with a potential client was to simply invite them to tour our offices and let them feel what was going on. It was truly special, but it was a double-edged sword. Without a doubt, the hardest thing to change is something that is successful. COVID-19, however, for all of the fear, heartache, loss, and challenges it created, also provided us great gifts. It gave us the gifts of urgency, desperation, and necessity. While not the greatest states to be in permanently and not without their trauma, we're not sure we would have embraced the change the way we did without these forces. That said, those three states don't bring out change alone. One of the other gifts we have is that our business is founded by a psychologist, Alison, and a behavioural scientist, Darren, and we know a fair bit about behaviour and cultural change. And one thing we know for sure is that even though conditions for change might be present, If the hard work of examining and shifting beliefs isn't undertaken, meaningful change is unlikely to occur, even if the consequences are dire. So, the starting point of our journey to hybrid team excellence was to invest the time in asking ourselves two critical questions. What type of team do we now need to be? What would we need to believe for that to occur? The following chapters are evidence of the work our whole team did in this space, while also providing an insight into the science and practice of other companies who are forging ahead in the pursuit of working from anywhere. We trust it'll be enlightening, and we'll see you at the start of the chapter. Chapter 1. The world has shifted. Shifting our world. There's every chance you've got this book in your hands because of a question. Potentially, it's a question along the lines of, how do we shift to work from anywhere? Or, what does work from anywhere really mean? It's possible that you're contemplating, can it really work? It is also possible that it's no longer a question of if your team can work remotely. This might already be a reality of your workforce, and you're mulling over the big questions, such as, how do we make it truly work? And how can I trust my team to work autonomously? These are all important questions, and they're the kinds of questions that some of the largest organizations globally and the teams within them are asking. For possibly the first time en masse in our economic history, questions about how we work, where we work, and what work actually means are being considered by all workplaces, regardless of size and industry. From the local coffee shop on the corner to our financial institutions, to the likes of multinational tech behemoth companies, all businesses have been affected. Leaders across the globe are contemplating these same questions, and many have made long-term commitments around Work From Anywhere, WFA, for their workforce. The world has seismically shifted. Where it was previously considered suboptimal to work away from an office, we are now seeing well-known companies globally committed to a WFA approach into the future. Organizations such as Stripe, Shopify, Facebook, and Twitter across 2020 all declared significant policy changes with a swing towards permanent or at least significant adoption of flexibility for their people to allow them to truly work from anywhere. Jack Dorsey, CEO of Twitter and Square, announced in May 2020 a permanent remote work policy that allows individual employees to make the choice about where they work and how. Shopify CEO Toby Lutke also announced in May 2020 they would embrace a remote workforce, claiming they were now digital by default. Lutke argued that for Shopify, their offices would become the place to support new hires to transition to remote working environments. For an organization such as Shopify, with customers who mostly work from home, having employees working from home also will create a stronger empathy of customers' experiences. The lead taken by these types of organizations has seen many others follow suit, with major parts of our populations now working from either home, co-working spaces, or locations other than an office. In fact, Nick Bloom from Stanford University outlined that in June 2020, 42% of the US labor force was working from home full time, with only 26% working at their business premises. The remaining were, at the time, out of work, a testament to the severe impact of the recession that flowed from COVID-19 and lockdown measures. With almost twice as many people working from home, Bloom argues the US is now a working-from-home economy. One of the most significant changes we came across in our research occurred in possibly the least-known giant company on the planet, Tata Consultancy Services, TCS. TCS is a large IT service company with a global reach. They have campuses across China, Hungary, America, and India. This company had invested heavily into bricks and mortar, creating places for people to gather, collaborate, ideate, and deliver work. However, in 2020, they made the decision that 75% of their 500,000-strong global workforce would work remotely within 3 years. This is a firm commitment to invest in the future of work in a different way, making the change not as a temporary response to a crisis, but as a chosen commitment to a long-term strategy in the way of work. In a focus story on their website, TCS argue that collectively, forward-thinking organizations are on the verge of a new work order that will render obsolete age-old concepts such as location dependency, defined and fixed working hours, high-touch governance, and presenteeism as a prerequisite to optimal productivity. Is this just a rebadge? Technology is a catalyst for change. It always has been. Since the first person who not only crafted a round object, but also had the curiosity to see what would happen if they attached this object to something else to help move it, they have known that technology changes the way we gather, transport, connect, and trade. The advent of the internet, combined with the evolution of work devices that packed in solid speed and grunt, alongside the ability to be used in a mobile fashion, meant that the way we work had been transformed. No longer are people tied to a location that houses a computer server or industrial blend coffee sachets. Remote work, flexible work practices, and the ability to work on the go are not new approaches. They have been a large part of the way we work for decades, allowing individuals with a range of requirements to access work in a way that works for them. But this does beg the question, is work from anywhere just a rebadge of old practices and principles? Or did the rush to remote work expose just how far short of the WFA mark we were? Policies and practices were grossly underprepared. The global pandemic of COVID-19 provided two gifts, if they can be called that. The first gift was the global experience of how quickly change can happen when the purpose is big enough. For the past 10 years or so, at Pragmatic Thinking, we've worked with organizations to drive change and craft impactful cultural shifts in organizations. We've worked on everything from shifting the safety culture to shifting the leadership culture and to driving a united culture across organizations that have grown rapidly through acquisition. One of the common pushbacks we get in this work stems from the belief that change takes time, particularly cultural change. We heard all too often that people are resistant to change. In fact, they simply don't like change. COVID-19 and the changes to workplaces that followed, however, showed us just how quickly change can occur and how swiftly people can adapt when they need to. The second gift that COVID-19 provided to workplaces is the realization that existing flexible work policies and practices were grossly underprepared to accommodate the requirements of a permanent shift of teams to both perform and connect virtually. And yet, people still found a way. The policies in place and tools available to work on the go were all embedded in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.